Now let's see in detail how HOG features are extracted. Now given any image, what you do is, you crop a small patch of it, which is in the ratio 1:2. For example, maybe this is 150 pixels in the x direction and 300 pixels in the y direction. So given this crop, you then resize it to 64 by 128, and this patch of the image you divide into 8 by 16 grid. So now each block in the grid will be 8 pixels by 8 pixels. So this is what is shown here. One block of the grid is being shown. I have not shown all the pixel values here to make the explanation easier, but I have shown just few of them. Now let's say I want to calculate the gradient magnitude and direction in this pixel position. How will I do that? For doing this, I have to calculate the difference in pixel intensities in both the x and y directions. For that, I need these 4 pixel values. And I would be ignoring all other pixels. And this is what is shown here. So in the x direction, the difference in pixel intensities would be 70 minus 40. And that's 30. And in the y axis, the difference in pixel intensities would be 20 minus 70. That is 50. I will be ignoring the sign here, so I'll be taking the absolute values. Now given these two values, how will I calculate the gradient magnitude? I'll just take the square root of these two numbers, that is 30 square plus 50 square, which will give me a value of 58. That's what is shown here. And the gradient direction will be tan inverse of these two numbers, which will be an angle of around 30 degrees. Now similarly, you will calculate the gradient magnitude and direction in all the pixel positions, but I've not shown all of them here. I've shown just few values in this row. Now what we do is, we use this gradient magnitude and direction to calculate the feature vectors. Now if you observe the gradient direction, you will see that all the angles are between 0 and 180 degrees. Now these angles I divide into 9 different bins. That is, from 0 to 20 degrees, I'll divide it into one bin, 20 to 40 one bin, 40 to 60 one bin, and so on. The last bin will be from 160 to 180 degrees. Once I do that, I'll check the gradient magnitude, gradient direction at any pixel position. In this case, it's 20 degrees. So I'll see what is the corresponding gradient magnitude. It is 60. So in the 20 degree bin, I'll put a value of 60. Next, here the gradient direction is 40, and the corresponding gradient magnitude is again 60. So I'll write 60 in the 40 degree bin. In the third example, the gradient direction is 30. This is right in between 20 and 40. So what I'll do is, this time I'll take the gradient magnitude, divide by half, and put 30 in the 20 degree bin and 30 in the 40 degree bin. Basically, I'm dividing this value by half and dividing them equally between 20 and 40 degrees bin. Now what if the gradient direction is 25? In this case, I have to divide it into 3/4 and 1/4. 3/4 because this 25 degrees is closer to the 20 degree bin than the 40 degree bin. And so now I'll put 45 here and 15 here. The magnitude 60 is divided into 45 and 15. Now what I will do is, I'll fill up this bin for all other pixel values, that is all the gradient magnitude and directions. Once I do that, I'll sum up the total value in each of these bins. So for 20 degree bin, here the total is 135, and for 40 degree, it's 105. Let's assume for 0 degree, it's around 50. Now my feature vector will be just the array of all these numbers, that is 50, 135, 105, and so on. The size will be 9. And when it comes to image processing, we usually express the arrays in terms of vectors. So this will be a vector of size 9. It can also be represented as matrix of size 9:1, that is 9 rows and 1 column. This histogram can also be represented pictorially in this way. What are these arrows? The first arrow stands for the 0 degree bin. This will be the 20 degree bin, 40 degree bin, and so on. And the length of this arrow will be proportional to the total magnitude in each of these bins. For example, for 0 degree, the length of this arrow will be 50 units. And for 20 degree, it will be 135, 40 will be 105, and so on. So here you can see in which direction the gradient magnitude is maximum. In this case, it's in this direction, it's maximum. But in all other angles, in all other directions, the gradient magnitude change, that is, the contrast is minimum in other angles. This way, I can easily represent the gradient magnitude and direction in an image. Now let's just recap what we did. We took an image, cut a small patch of it in the ratio 1:2. That is, say this is 150 pixels and this is 300. Then we resized this image, this patch to 64 by 128. This patch we divided into 8 by 16 grid, and every block of the grid will be 8 by 8 pixels each. For every block, I calculated a feature vector that is of size 9. Next, what I do is, I'll combine 4 such feature vectors in the adjacent blocks to create a concatenated feature vector of size 36. Once I do that, I'll move this window one block to the right. Again, I'll concatenate these 4 feature vectors to give me another feature vector of size 36. Similarly, I'll do it till the end of the row. In total, how many blocks do I have? I have 7 such blocks per row. Once I finish the first row, then I'll move one block down, and I'll repeat this process. Similarly, I'll do it for all the blocks within the grid. So this will be the my final block that I'll be concatenating. So here, for a 8 by 16 grid, I will end up with 7 × 15, so many feature vectors. And each of the feature vector is of size 36. In total, for this patch of the image, my HOG feature will be of length 3780. Now, there is one small detail that I left out. After concatenating 4 feature vectors into a size of 36, I will also normalize it. Now, what is normalization? Let's say you have 2 numbers, 2 and 4. And if you want to normalize it, what you do is you'll take the square root of 2 square and 4 square, which will give you a number 4.472. Then you divide both these numbers by the same number, same value. You will get 0.44 and 0.89. What if you double these two numbers? That is, you will get 4 and 8. Again, if you normalize these two numbers, you will get back 0.44 and 0.89. So why is this normalization useful? Let's say you take all the pixel values of this image and multiply by 2 to increase the brightness, or say you divide it by 2 to reduce the brightness. Then if you want to compare these two images, you may not be able to get a perfect match because now the pixel intensity values have changed. But if you normalize it, your feature vectors will be very similar to each other and it will be easy to compare. Now this is one example of HOG feature extraction of this arrow image. This I have extracted using the SK image library. Here we can see that in these two patches, wherever the portion is just white or black, there is no change in the contrast in any of these pixels, and hence my HOG feature, that is my gradient magnitudes, are almost non-existent. And in other places of the image, wherever you are transitioning either from the white region to the black one or from the black region to the white one, we can see all the feature vectors being extracted and depicted here. And if you are wondering what these marks are, it is nothing but the pictorial representation of the gradient magnitude and direction that we discussed previously. And as we already discussed, when you are transitioning from the white region to the black one, here the change in gradient magnitude is along the x-axis mostly. So that's what you can see here. And in this edge, the change is in the y-axis. So even here you can observe the same thing. One more observation is that this corner looks very different from this one. So even this change, the difference in how the corner looks, can be observed using these feature vectors. And the last observation is, even if you take the edges that are inclined, that is, this is the backward inclination and this is the forward inclination, the gradient magnitude or the feature vector representation looks similar, but they are in a different direction. So you can even know based on this in which way the edges are aligned. Another example of HOG features being extracted on a human body. Here we can clearly see that wherever there is a face or hands or any other interesting portions of the image, the HOG features are clearly able to extract them. And all the other patches of the image where there is not much information, we can see that even the gradient magnitude values are very less. And in places where there is uniform pixel intensities, there is not much change here. Even the HOG features depict the same thing. The last thing that we discussed was that it's not necessary that change in magnitude should be very sudden like in these edges, but it can also be gradual as we can see in this portion. So the same thing can be seen here. The HOG features are extracted, but the gradient magnitude values are small compared to other portions in the image. This, in short, is how HOG feature extraction works. Now you might ask, how will I use it in my practical situation? Now let's say you want to do some object detection. Let's take the task of detecting humans from images. How will you do it? What you have to do is, given any patch of the image, you extract the HOG features. Once you extract, you convolve these features with the human template. That is, this is a filter for how the HOG features for human should look. And once you do the convolution, you will get an output that like this. And this output, you feed it to a classifier like SVM or any other classifier, which will be able to tell you whether this is a human or not. If you are not aware of the concepts of convolution and SVM, these two things I'll be covering in the next two videos. If you already know these concepts, you can skip the next two videos and then continue the course.